I come at this as a, from a psychotherapist perspective. That's one of my perspectives. I work in end of life, grief and bereavement. And I use pretty much all these end of life experiences, which we call shared crossings. These, I'll say more about what shared crossings are, but they're spiritual experiences at the end of life, also known as in the medical community as end of life phenomena or transpersonal spiritual experiences at the end of life. There are so many different names for these experiences, depending on the discipline you're studying in or your perspective. But the point being is that I found in my own life personally, but then professionally, these experiences open doorways to profound psycho-spiritual evolution. And that's what a lot of people come to me for psychotherapeutic work. It's really less about psychology and more about spiritual transformation and growth. So there's my professional background. I should also say I had two near-death experiences, one when I was 17 and the other when I was 30. Very different types. First was a kind of a all going, you know, high-speed skiing accident, catapulted out of my body, went through a beautiful galaxy all the way to the light and pled to come back. And here I am. And then at 30 years old, that would be about 13 years after my first NDE, I had a very severe blood imbalance that left me in the ICU for a couple of days, intensive care unit for a couple of days, floating above my body for a few hours at least on the first night I was there, just completely without any identity, just an observing self until the doctor came in and called out to me saying, "Mr. Peters, I want to talk to you." And at that point I realized, oh, that's me in that bed. So those are two experiences as well. I should also say I've been a hospice worker and had a number of the shared crossing experiences during that time. And then I have a good deal of, unfortunately, cancer is something that seems to be genetically active in my family. So I've been with a lot of family members dying at young ages. Okay, with that by way of introduction, and as I'm the founder of the Shared Crossing Project and the director of our research initiative, and I'll say a little bit about our scholarly work in a moment. So this is what I want to cover today. I want to address, you know, introduce everybody to the Shared Crossing Project and to the research initiative. I want to review the findings from our most recent study that was published in the American Journal of Hospice and Palliative Medicine. I want to identify the positive aspects or after effects of the SDE for the experiencers. I really want to assert that the SDEs suggest a continuation of consciousness beyond human death. Now, for those on this call, really know this to be true, but I think the angle that the SDE presents is one that is quite compelling. And I can tell you that the medical community is listening to these experiences. In my own community, and our research team is getting lots of inquiries about, hey, what is this experience you've identified in the American Journal of Hospice Palliative Care? So there is a good deal of focus on the shared death experience. And I'd say that's for the first time. So I want to say that the mission of the Shared Crossing Project, it is to positively transform people's relationship to death and dying, end of life generally, through really raising awareness and educating people about these end of life experiences. Like I say, we call them shared crossings because they are so healing and they offer such a sense of peace and calm, not just about what happens at death, but about how we can live our life now. Our Shared Crossing Research Initiative, this is the research arm of the Shared Crossing Project, and it is multidisciplinary. I come at this from a mental health background, a transpersonal psychotherapist, as I've mentioned already. We have our medical director is Dr. Monica Williams. She's an emergency department physician. And then we have Dr. Michael Kinsella. He is comes at this from a humanities background in religious studies. We study these phenomena called shared crossings, and I'll say more about those in a second. We are collecting and analyzing shared crossing accounts. We've been doing this now for about 5 years, and our focus is on the therapeutic benefits or just the positive after effects, and we really advocate for education about shared crossings. Here's the real short definition of this: an end-of-life phenomenon that suggests loving communication across the veil and ongoing contact with our departed loved ones. The primary features that we study here are, and you can see this is our spectrum of end of life experience. And I created this spectrum of end of life experiences as a clinician about 8 years ago. I was a researcher, and then I started getting all sorts of reports, end of life experiences. I had put out kind of a call for shared death experiences, and because the definition wasn't that well known, people started coming to me for everything. So as all these different types of end of life experiences came in, I created this spectrum. Now, to be sure, I did a thorough lit review and found that others in the field were interested in this, most notably Dr. Peter Fenwick out of UK. He had really identified a lot of the features that you see on the approaching death side of the spectrum. So as you look at this spectrum, you can see approaching death on the left side, and then you move into death, which is depicted as a wide cylinder. I do that because I want us to look at death as it truly is. It is not a set moment in time where your brain waves stop or your heart stops. In my experience, death happens minutes and sometimes hours. This titration of the soul, spirit, consciousness from this human life into the afterlife, back and forth for some period of time. And that graphic helps provide some insight into that. Then we have the experiences on the other side of death, the after death side, and you can see those phenomena as well. I'm only going to focus on the shared death experience today. That's what my book is about, At Heaven's Door. But I will say the other experience is on here. If you or anyone you know have these experiences, please reach out to me and my research team, because we want to hear your accounts. So just by way of kind of historical relevancy of the shared death experience, Frederick Myers, co-founder of the Society for Psychical Research and author of the primary author of the tome, Human Personality and Its Survival of Bodily Death. This was a graphic really early on in this book. And what you see here, if you can't see this, that this first, the lower horizontal axes there, you see 1 week at the very bottom, 1 week before moment of death. Moment of death is that line going vertically and the highest line, almost like the mast of a sail. And then you see 1 year going out from the moment of death. Well, what this is a very illustrative graph or chart, because it shows where the highest frequency of what Myers and his team refer to as apparitions at death or apparitions around death. And that apex there is where the shared death experience lives. And so keep that in mind as we go forward. So what is a shared death experience? It's an experience where a loved one, caregiver, or bystander reports that if they feel like they shared in the transition of a dying person's journey from this human existence into the afterlife. And they use the term afterlife, and they often refer to it as a glorious, loving, wondrous, mystical afterlife. Those are the adjectives we tend to hear. The dominant motif is journey. We hear this all the time. There is a movement that the shared death experiencer observes. The movement, quite just to be redundant, but it's illustrative, from their human life into the afterlife. And then the relationship appears to be central. There seems to be a bond between the person dying and the experiencer loved one. The features are very similar to the near-death experience, except in most cases, or at least some of the cases, the perspective is different. And I'll say a little bit more about how that works. So to be clear, we've conducted a research study. It was from 2017 to 2020. There were 107 shared death experiencers deeply analyzed by my team. There were 164 SDE accounts. Now, if you look at the data right away, you say, hey, wait a minute. That means a lot of people are having repeat SDEs, and that's absolutely true. About 41% of our SDE experiencers had more than one. And that's something to keep in mind as well when we think about how these experiences happen. And once again, to be clear, this is published in December 2021 in the American Journal of Hospice and Palliative Medicine. And another interesting comment about this is the review board, of course, is a peer-reviewed magazine or journal. they were thrilled to receive this study and said, they were almost giddy saying, we know these experiences happen. We've heard about them anecdotally, but we've never received a study that was so robust in numbers and analysis. So that was really wonderful to receive such a warm welcome from this journal. So we'll start with the basics of the SDE. There are two main types. Bedside is what we call the first type. That means you're at the bedside of the dying. You're right there, present with them. There's also remote, not at the bedside. That means you're either down the hall, across town, or across the world. Space makes no difference in the SDE. In fact, probably the most profound finding from our research was that while Raymond Moody originally talked about the SDE in his book, Glimpses of Eternity, he did this based on letters that he received from people saying, hey, I didn't have a near-death experience. I mean, I had a near-death experience in terms of the way the NDE is defined, like the features and such, but I wasn't near-death myself. I was at the bedside of my loved one dying, and this is what I had. So Raymond collected all those cases and wrote a book about it. But what we found in our research is that 64% of SDEs happen remotely, not at bedside. That's a spectacular finding, at least from you can see how excited I am, because it really does go to support this aspect of non-local consciousness, which is something that I think all of us in end-of-life studies have been, you know, trying to get the world to wake up to. There's another two subtypes here as well, and the two subtypes have to do with time variation. So we can see SDEs happening, you know, moments, hours, in some cases even a day earlier than the actual medically defined time of death, or they can be delayed. That means same thing, minutes, hours, even up to a day or two on the after side of death, if you will. We also see gradual SDEs. That means they start anytime just before death or around death, a little bit after, and they continue going on and on, or going on, then go, you come back into the normal human common reality, then you go back into the SDE reality. So we have cases like that as well. Fully a quarter of our cases, 24%, will happen either before, after, or gradually in relationship to the medically defined time of death. We also have multi-person SDEs. That means more than one person will participate in the SDE, and they could have a similar experience, or they can have a similar and different experience, or they can have a completely different experience. And they can also be at bedside together, or they can be at, one can be bedside, one can be remote, or multiple variations of all of that. What we see here is that the SDE has a tremendous diversity of experiences available to it. This is one of the questions that I had looked at deeply as a clinician. What is the experience of the loved one, caregiver, bystander in the SDE? So what is the experiencer's experience? And I identified four modes of experiencing the SDE. The first one is remotely sensing a death. And I'm going to go into each one of these in more detail. The second is witnessing unusual phenomena. Third one is accompanying the dying. And the third is assisting the dying in transitioning. So let's go through these. Remotely sensing a death. This happens in 25% of our cases. Now, just so you know, these are not mutually exclusive. So you'll see that our broadest category in terms of the mode of participation is the second category, witnessing death-related phenomena. But in the remotely sensing, what you see here is these are brief thoughts, feelings, sensations around the time of death that relate to some sort of death or tragedy. And I'll explain a little bit more about that. And then there's also this other type of sensing, which is sudden onset of physical symptoms. And we call it SDE. So what we're going to see now is Sarah M. Now, Sarah M is going to be talking about an experience that happened when her niece Layla was dying of an accidental drug overdose. So an accidental drug overdose. And she'll explain a little bit about it. But Sarah is in California, actually in Santa Barbara, and her niece is on the East Coast. So listen to Sarah here.
I have a lot of nieces and nephews, and I love them all, but I'm probably much closer to Sophie and Lila, both of them, than my others, just because they've been in my life. They're kind of surrogate daughters because of their close proximity all through high school. And at about 3:45 on Sunday morning, I woke up abruptly with, a severe cramp in my leg. It was something I've had cramps before, but nothing like that. And I sort of leapt out of bed and was jumping up and down. And my husband got up and said, "Oh, she's got a cramp." And he went into the bathroom. And when he came out, I had just sort of fallen back onto the bed. And I apparently, this part I don't remember, I was stiff and like seizing. My eyes were rolling back in my head and I was having what he would describe as a mild seizure. Both our kids happened to be home that weekend. They're both college aged. And he called them and he told my daughter to call 911 because he really thought something was wrong. And I guess I was in that state for about a minute or a minute and a half. And when I came to, he was, talking to me. And I said, no, I said, I'm okay. And I guess he had Julia cancel the call. And then I started just profusely sweating. And I looked at my son and I said, "That was the strangest experience." I looked right at him and I said, "I had this moment while I was in that whatever state I was." And I said, I'm dying, or this is what it feels like to die. And then I got up and I went in the bathroom. And then for about 2 hours, I was violently ill. And it wasn't anything I'd eaten, because I never get stomach. And we'd all had the same thing for dinner the night before. It was just, so my first thought in the morning was to call my sister, because she's a nurse. And I called and I said, "Shoshana, what do you think of this?" And she was, racking her brains. And I don't know, you should go to the doctor. It could be heart related. She was thinking of all these things, but the combination of symptoms were odd. And 20 minutes later, my sister called me back and said that Lila had died. And it was just pure shock. We all were in complete shock. And sometime between Friday night and Saturday, she got some fentanyl-laced heroin, and she snorted it, and it probably took her pretty instantly, as it is prone to do. But I think it was fairly soon that day that I started thinking, well, that is so, what else could that have been? And because of my feeling of that it was this is what it feels like to die, I think that I started processing that day that maybe I had a visit from Lila on some level, on some spiritual level.
That's a sympathetic SDE, and you can see how Sarah has these inclinations, thoughts that link her experience directly to Lila's overdose. Now, it helps on our research team that we have Dr. Monica Williams, who's an emergency department physician. And when she reviewed the case with us, she was like, "Well, that's Sarah's symptoms are identical to what we see with drug overdoses of this kind." So it seems like she was tapping into Lila. Now, we could even stretch this a little bit further, because now, having seen a few dozen of these cases, a lot of times the experiencer, Sarah didn't say this, but sometimes the experiencer will say, "I felt like this person, the dying, was reaching out to me in some way, struggling, reaching out for support." Sarah doesn't say this, but we sometimes feel that bond between the transitioning and the experiencer, who's obviously surviving and healthy in mind and body. So let's move on here. So that was the first type of mode of participation that we've identified, sensing at a distance. Here's the second mode of participation for the experiencer: witnessing unusual phenomena, And these phenomena are usually linked to, well, really, they're just, if you look at these, they're kind of either near-death phenomena or something similar in the realm of apparitions. So when visions of the dying, we see 51% of the time, transcendent light, a quarter of the time, sensing strong energy, alterations time-space, encounters with non-human entities, seeing the spirit leave the body. We're going to have a great case right now on video of spirit leaving body. Encounters with deceased loved ones, that's 13%, but that number is lower because our newer cases, for whatever reason, are bringing more of these. And then seeing heavenly realms, that too is low. So our next case is going to be with Sally. And Sally's going to be sharing an experience where she is at bedside with her mother, and she's going to be talking about the spirit leaving body. Now, I really want to encourage you all to listen closely to Sally's description, because this is a clinic in a firsthand, close to, and highly sensitive report on a spirit, soul, consciousness, what have you, leaving a physical body at the time of death.
I saw this membranous type thing come away from the whole periphery of her body. And it was defined. It was definitely an edge. And as it came apart, coming up from the body to fill this thing was like this gray stuff. And I say stuff because, you know, I've been thinking about this since I talked to you guys, and I just cannot put my hand on anything specific to tell you what it was like. I mean, yeah, foggy, no, it had a little more particulate stuff to it. It was something in this form at this time, solid enough that it was still in a three-dimensional thing for me to see. So it moved, though. It congealed, and it slowly came together around her. And this membrane, and I think this had to be three-dimensional, but I could only see two dimensions in this thing. So this membrane opened like this and started going up towards the corner as a little bit, like, you know, like a feather edge started going up of the grayish stuff, started going up with the tunnel. I called it a tunnel. I don't know if it was three-dimensional, but anyhow. And as it started to go up, the rest started to follow more solid. Now, I'm picturing the room. I'd say about halfway up to that corner, it started going a little faster from the body and the corner, and a little less fast up to the corner where it started to disappear, this tube and the edges of the tube anyhow. And it just kept going up, and soon it was all out of her body and almost all disappeared at the top until the very last bit just went up fast. Once she's up in the corner there, I'm looking up there, I know she's up there. And I feel this love come into my body. It just was so wonderful. It just poured into my body, you know, and I didn't get goosebumps or anything. It just was love and filled me totally. And I smiled. And I probably was, I don't know if I was more than smiling, but I know I was extremely happy, extremely happy. After a while, she was back. I think she was looking at them. And then after a while, she came back to me and she sent me a message. It wasn't just the love that I felt before. It was different. It was like, oh, I am so full of joy. I'm so happy. This is her. And I felt that. I felt her.
So really a beautiful account by Sally. She was so relieved to you know, to have the interview with us, as so many of our research participants are, because they feel like they get a lot of support and affirmation to share this most profound experience. that doesn't get a lot of support in our culture. So here's, you know, once again, you see the really beautiful, clear, exquisite description of the spirit, her mother's spirit leaving body, going to the top, hovering at the ceiling. We do see that. We do hear of these spirits leaving and then kind of hovering above. And not that they see them anymore, but they sense their departed loved one in the corner of the room, typically at the ceiling. And then there's a relationship, an interaction that takes place, and Sally defined it beautifully. Like, I love you. Thank you. I'm going now, but I want you to know I'm happy and I'm well. Wow, what a beautiful gift to be given by to us as surviving loved ones in the human realm. So here's the third type mode of participation, accompanying the dying. So occur out of body or in a visionary realm. Okay, so that means you are, if you're the experiencer, you are with the dying in some way. And you could be just out of body, or you could be in a visionary realm, like a heavenly realm is typically where what we see. And you're progressing on the journey with the dying. Movement and ascension toward the light are typical reports we receive. The landscape or the environment is beautiful. It's heavenly, hyper alive. They also report receiving a special types of knowledge and insight about the nature, ultimate nature of reality. Basically, the sense that everything is one, light and love. All of the teachings that, you know, we kind of know from the metaphysical literature, if you will. And then the appearance of a border that the experiencer realizes is a boundary beyond which they cannot pass. So we're not going to do a video on this one, but we're going to do a video on the next one, which is assisting. But assisting the dying is, you know, identical to the accompanying with one additional piece. The participant in this one, the experiencer reports that they feel like they're assisting the dying or even guiding the dying in this transition. So this case we're going to see is with Mark. And Mark is with his father. Now, Mark, I should say, this is with his father, but Mark is actually in New Jersey finishing a week-long intensive outdoor education program he was doing. So he's on the East Coast of the United States, and Mark's father is dying in Canada. So this is a very remote case. So here's Mark.
You know, there's that connection that we have with other people that we love, you know, like in particular with my father, I had that connection and I still do. I could feel my father. I was like, I need to check in on him, you know? And so I sent my spirit to the hospital where I knew he was. I remember going to him at his bedside and speaking to him and saying, you know, Dad, it's like, why don't you just let go? You know, Mom's going to be all right. You know, all us kids are going to be all right. You know, you can go. Like, there's nothing holding you here anymore. And he looks at me. The puzzlement was in his face as he said, I don't know how. I knew right away, as soon as I was there with my dad, picked him up. And I started that meditation, you know, walking down this particular trail. And at a certain point, turn and step up these stairs and walking towards the light. So we're walking side by side. And I took him to the light. And as we got close, my father and my grandmother had a really, really close and beautiful and amazing magical relationship. As we got close to the light, you know, there's like a doorway where the numinosity of the light coming out of there was just was unbelievable. And my grandmother steps out of that light. And she's standing there. And my dad, the look on his face was just so peaceful and beautiful. And as we approached the light, my grandmother and my uncle both, first my grandmother stepped out of the light. Yeah, they were very, very close. And so again, it's the look of joy on his face when he saw my grandmother was just like a look I hadn't seen in his face in years and years and years. And he just went and hugged her and hugged her. And my uncle came out of the lake at that point. And he joined the fray, and the three of them were just, you know, the joy was just unbelievable. And, you know, none of them touched me. You know, they were very, 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 very clearly that I wasn't part of that group. But, you know, that my job was done. Like, I brought my dad there, and now, like, they had it. It was really how it felt. And they didn't speak to me either. And then my dad, he just turns and looks at me, and it's just this huge smile on his face. And he said, I didn't know that it was this easy. I woke the next morning, and the phone rang, and it was for me. And I answered the phone. I said, it was my brother. And he said, you know, Dad passed away. And I said, yeah, I know.
So, you know, here you see that Mark is he's invited into his father's transition. Now you can tell Mark is really quite sensitive, intuitive, almost has shamanistic qualities to him, actually. And he shows up and he orients his father and takes him towards the light, where he then is reacquainted with his, Mark's grandmother and Mark's uncle, who obviously are his father's mother and brother. And Mark is very clear that he is not really, he's done his job. He's not invited to anything more than that. In other words, he reaches his boundary and realizes he's going to have to go back. But he has that final lovely interaction with his father thanking him and saying goodbye. And so one thing I want other people to note is there's also this journey movement. There's always this movement towards the light. And in this case, very typical, an ascension, an upward movement, something that we see as a feature in the SDE. So I want to talk about one of the features of the SDE that is the most interesting to me, one that I have experienced myself. In fact, I share an experience with my father in my book that I will say it's, I mean, Wendy, you might have a comment about this, but that is the one when I do book signings and presentations or about the book specifically, this is the experience of my father is the one that the people want to hear the most about. But the conductor is this force that seems to be orchestrating or facilitating the transition. It appears in different ways, different forms. It can be angels. It can be previously deceased loved ones. Sometimes it's an unknown figure that just appears. It's often beautiful and awesome in description, light-filled. And then sometimes the conductor is not seen. It's just sensed or felt. And this is also curious that you feel this force that's guiding things, that's in charge, but you can't locate it in your visual field. The purpose of the conductor is known. It is to orchestrate this transition. But what's so interesting is the personality about the conductor also seems to be consistent. It's very focused, very intent. Very directive. It seems to be forceful even in orchestrating or managing this transition of a soul, spirit, consciousness from a human body into the afterlife. The case we're going to see now is with Angela. And Angela is with her mother-in-law. She actually walks into the bedroom where her mother-in-law is dying, and she'll talk about seeing two angels. I want you to really look at the description that Angela gives for how she sees her mother-in-law's spirit leaving her physical body. Think about what we just saw with Sally, and then compare it to what Angela describes, and then really focus on these two spirit light beings that look like angels, but they don't have heads, which is, you know, hey, angels have changed over the years, I guess. So here we go.
I didn't particularly have a close relationship with her, unfortunately. I wished it had been, it was close at the end. Jean, my mother-in-law, she wasn't with it. She was completely unconscious, and she wasn't even being fed. She was on heavy medication now. As I went into the kitchen and I just glanced over, I noticed that the room was a welcoming gold colour. And it looked as though you wanted to be in there. As I got to the room, it felt like the whole room was in some kind of a bubble and not to enter it. I felt as though I shouldn't go into that room. So, but as I noticed, Jean had something not out of her head, but in like the centre of her body here, was about a foot away from her body. It was translucent and it was moving out of her body. But you could see through it. I couldn't believe it. And in the corner of the room, the very corner to the left, in the right in the corner, there was a massive angel with huge wings. It looked like a bird, white wings. I say it's an angel. I don't know. It didn't even have a head, to be honest with you. But it was a white being. It was white. It wasn't translucent. And its wings were moving with the tips of them, moving inwards like that. Beckoning motion, a strong beckoning. I thought, I couldn't believe it. And she was like moving, she wasn't shape, she was just translucent, irregular ball. Not even a ball, it was irregular shape. It wasn't a shape of a person or anything. And it was moving up to this white being that was doing this movement, but there was another smaller one the other side doing the same movement. Exactly. And there was a very, very, very high-pitched tone, and it felt as though this was all included with the bubble that was in this whole room. This white being seemed to turn to me in quite a, I don't know how to put this, in quite a, it was telepathically, but it turned to me, it didn't even have a head, but it turned to me and it said to me, wait, wait. And this other little one, the other side, seemed to turn to it in a panicking kind of way, as if to say, what are we going to do now? And was doing it as well. They were going a bit faster and a bit of an urgency going on. So I said to Dorothy, she's definitely died. And with that, Dorothy come barging past me into the room. And as she got into the room, and she disappeared into the corner.
So once again, Angela does an excellent job of describing a shared death experience. She's having the shared death experience. But once again, notice the similarities between what how Sally described the spirit leaving the body and what Angela described. So it's very similar in terms of, you know, where it leaving out of the middle of the body, or, you know, the chest or the throat area. But it's a very similar kind of imagery of gradually departing the body, heading upwards, and then up into the corner of the room there. And then the two angels, once again, I refer to this angel, the lead angel there, the larger one, as the conductor, very directive, kind of looking at Angela, or at least putting out saying, wait, wait, creating the conditions to enable this facilitation of the soul spirit consciousness out of the human body and into the next dimension. And I even love the description of the hands or the wings coaxing the spirit, seemingly coaxing, its interpretation, the spirit out of the human body. So let's look at the major SDE after effects. And, you know, like I said, as a psychotherapist, this, you know, all the phenomena is spectacular, but this is why I am compelled to carry out the mission of the Shared Crossing Project, because the healing benefits are so positive. So SDE experiencers believe the deceased loved ones are alive and well somewhere. And these are, by the way, these are self-reported, unsolicited responses. So these are minimum figures. So 67% believe their loved ones are alive and well in a benevolent afterlife. 87% are convinced of an afterlife. Grief reconciliation, that's the process of grieving itself. 69% have an improved or enhanced grief reconciliation. So what does that mean? That means that their grieving process is held with more understanding, a deeper sense that death is a natural part of life. And so this is not to say that they don't feel pain or sorrow or heartbreak at the loss of a loved one. That would not be very natural. But they seem to understand that grief is a natural part, or death is a natural part of life. And grief is the price we pay for loving deeply. The fourth element here, or after effect, is reduction in fear of death. This is 52%, and I am sure it's higher. We just didn't ask this question all the time. We don't ask it directly, period. And then renewed purpose in life, that has to do with people returning, feeling like they have a better understanding for the purpose, not just of a human life generally, but of their own specific purpose in life. So you'll see people come back and make rather significant life changes within the next year or two. But by that, I mean changing their profession or work, changing major relationships, living differently, more healthily typically. So here are the remarkable findings from our studies. And I already mentioned the first one: about almost two thirds of SDEs occur remotely. 64% engaged in a range of meditative activities. That means, you know, mindfulness activities we use this very broadly. So prayer, meditation, yoga. Some people even talk about regular practices of walking in nature or just sitting in silence of any kind. All these seem to correlate with SDE experiencers. 41% have more than one. And here's a really interesting statistic, which I love because it allows me to do more research on these end-of-life experiences generally. 79% reported other post-death shared crossing phenomena after their SDE, the most common one being post-death visions and visitations. So just to be really clear about what this means about the afterlife, or to say in more scientific terms, continuation of consciousness beyond human death. Three main points here. The SDE validates the NDEs. Of course, the NDEs, I'll go into that in a second. These are the highlights, and I'll go into a little more detail. SDE experiencers see the deceased in a post-mortem existence, and remote SDEs occur in unsuspecting minds of experiencers. So let's just lay this out. So here are the common features you see in SDEs and NDEs. I've been through this already a bit, but encounters with spirit beings, transcendent light, life reviews, unusual energy, alterations, time, space, heavenly realms, sense of presences, tunnels, borders, and boundaries in the spirit realm, profound peace, feelings of connectivity and unity experiences. Well, the near-death experience is, we know what that is. It's a brush with death, typically, although near-death experiences can also be induced with trauma as well. But the shared death experience occurs in caregivers, bystanders, loved ones who are actually not dying. SDEers are healthy in mind and body. So the SDE validates the NDE. They validate a very similar common phenomena. And in a sense that it identifies a common geography, suggesting survival of consciousness beyond human death. So what I'm saying is SDEs and NDEs really reflect a similar, if not identical, afterlife space right after human death. That, I'm not saying this is the entirety of the afterlife, because it is not, but it does mark that transition space between human death and the initial stages of the afterlife. The SDE occurs in physiologically normal brains, so the SDE cannot be dismissed as dying brain phenomena, which is often attributed to by the medical profession in the NDE experience, you know, the kind of the fear-death experience. So the scientific medical view cannot account for these anomalies, the SDE or the NDE? And certainly the SDE really pushes it. SDE experiencers see the deceased in the afterlife. So experiencers see the dying in the afterlife. And this is what we see with Mark's case in particular. He saw his father alive and well, but he also saw his grandmother and uncle very much at peace, very alive and healthy, and serving as a welcoming party for his father. Well, these phenomena too suggest a continuation of consciousness beyond human death. And finally, remote SDEs occur in unsuspecting minds of experiencers. So once again, we can go hearken on Mark's case, but Sarah's as well, that the experiencer had no idea of their loved one's death. There was no stimuli for the experiencer to know that the loved one was dying. This contradicts the theory that consciousness arises from the brain in response to stimuli in the environment. This is the modern medical neurological explanation for all human experience. This the SDE contradicts this, or provides a cases that do not fit in this paradigm. And so it suggests survival of consciousness beyond human death, obviously implying as well non-local consciousness. Okay, the obvious: current medical science cannot account for consciousness, and continuation of consciousness beyond human death is supported by SDEs. Final comments here. We are just beginning to study SDEs. And I want to thank Raymond Moody for his initial research. Also, Dr. Peter Fenech, he has a term, deathbed coincidences. He was really instrumental in kind of raising the awareness of this. And then at this point in time, I hope I'm going to invite other researchers to join us. But at this point in time, the Shared Crossing Research Initiative is the lead in this. And so we welcome other collaborators. The SDE remains largely a mystery. But the SDE is so worthy of further exploration and advocacy because of the positive after effects. All right, if you've had an SDE or a shared crossing experience, please reach out to our research team, sharedcrossing.com, or write us at info@sharedcrossing.com. We're easy to find on the internet. And you should also, if you're interested in resources, our website has a ton of resources there on SDEs and shared crossings. And our story library has about 8 or 9 firsthand accounts in addition to what you see here. In fact, none of these accounts I shared on this presentation are in our story library right now, but it's a great place to learn about SDEs. So for those of you who lead groups, you can refer, if you would, to our story library, because you can see firsthand accounts of SDEs. We are inviting people to join us as interns. We're starting an intern program. And 6 months is what we require, 5 to 15 hours a week. We have all these different themes in the SDE that we're interested in studying. One, example of, we want to figure out the relationship between death anxiety being reduced by SDEs, things like how do SDEs happen, more research on the conductor. It's a variety of fascinating subjects, and we just need teams to go in and work with me and my research team to really study these. Here's my book if you're interested. Thanks so much. I think this is, I was really trying to make this user friendly. Like, you could just be drawn into this by the stories themselves. So you don't have to be an expert, but by the time you get through the 29 stories, you will really have been given a real deep exploration of the SDE. And if you want to learn more, I have a course that I'm starting on April 27th. We call it the transformational journey of life and death beyond life and love beyond death. This is the first online course ever taught on the SDE. It's the first course that's ever been taught that I'm aware of that's focusing on the SDE. You're going to really get a sense for the deeper patterns, all of the after effects. It's probably going to show 30 plus videos in this course. And we'll be doing things like guided visualizations and all. So it's really going to be, it's going to be experiential too. So people will get an opportunity to meet each other. Sometimes people are, a lot of times people say, I want to meet more people who've had these experiences that are interested in them. And that's what the course is designed to do, to find a good, really create community around these. You do not have to have an SDE to participate. You just have to be interested. Okay, so I'm done. Thank you for your attention. I hope I didn't go too long, but I think I did go a little over.